I want to divide my comments into two parts. So first, let's put Hinduism aside. So at least we can relax. Okay? Yeah, relax. There's no. Okay. We'll talk about grand narrative. What is a grand narrative? And does a nation need a grand narrative? What are examples of grand narratives that different nations have? And how do these grand narratives come about? Who makes one? What is its use? What happens if it breaks down? So we should know that before we talk about Hinduism, whether it's relevant or not. Because you could have many kinds of grand narratives. So grand narrative is basically the overall story of who we are. It may be partly true and partly fantasy. Most countries' grand narratives include a lot of exaggeration, you know, some mythology, fiction, some outright lies also, some wishful thinking, but a large amount of truth also. So it's a narrative of our collective identity. Like I have a Rajiv identity. This is what I want to project. But it may have a lot of things that are more like advertising and promoting myself, and some truth also. Each person has individual identity, and you have identity as a department. You have an identity as a corporate business. So a nation also has identity. So this grand narrative of a nation is that kind of thing. To give you some examples, United States has a grand narrative. The official term of who we are in America, whether this may sound strange to you, but there is a term called American exceptionalism. Okay, how many of you have heard of that term? American exceptionalism. Okay, one or two. So if you look up American exceptionalism, it means we, the Americans, who are the world's exceptional people. And why we are the exceptional people? What are the qualities that made us exceptional? It's a very well-defined term. In the 1800s, it was coined, and the Senate passed laws and bills and referred to it. And even today, whether you are Republican or Democrat, left, right, you talk about what is your idea of American exceptionalism. You may have different idea of what makes us exceptional from someone else, but you have to have some idea about why we are exceptional. That's a common denominator. I wrote a 70-80 page paper which was published in a book called by Palgrave Macmillan, and my title was American Exceptionalism and the Myth of the Frontier. Now this idea of frontier is a very big idea in the American imagination, that we are people who are always facing a frontier and we must conquer that. Because their history started when they came as settlers from England, then the frontier was 99% of America was Native Americans living there. That was the big wild frontier, scary, but also a lot of riches if you could tame it, if you could capture it, adventure, you know, all the Wild West, romance, all that stuff was in the frontier. So the frontier was gradually captured and so-called civilized. So there's a dichotomy between us, civilization, and them, the frontier. And that's the whole story of America. And then when the whole frontier is captured, then the frontier goes overseas. They decide now we can't be Americans unless we have some frontier to challenge, to go after. So there's an invasion of Philippines for no reason. Philippines never provoked. There was no threat from them, but it was decided that this will be a good place to expand our frontier. So this kind of a frontier mindset is very American. And I've written in this, then, you know, Korea becomes the frontier, then Vietnam, now Iraq becomes the frontier, Afghanistan, and I'm actually writing a book on is India the next frontier, next American frontier. Okay, that's why I was writing all this, because I wanted to see what is their lens through which they're projecting. And I found very amazingly, all this talk about human rights problems in India, same thing were used to invade Mexico. That they lack human rights, they ill-treat their women, they're not good parents, you know, they are this, that, all kind of bad character that we will help them civilize. And you may or may not know, but until some generations back, California was part of Mexico, Arizona was part of Mexico, Texas was part of Mexico, a huge percentage of United States was not part of the United States. There was a war just to invade and take over. And there was no logic given other than that they are sort of primitive bad characters. They need to be invaded, this sort of thing. So there's a grand narrative. So this is an expansionist grand narrative. Then, you know, Arabs have a grand narrative. based on Islam. They have a grand narrative of their place in the world and their destiny and what they are supposed to do to expand their share of earth, you know. So that there's a grand narrative like that. The Chinese have a grand narrative. So there's also, you know, if you look at China, they have a grand narrative about who they are, their past. And according to that narrative, they're teaching everybody. Everyone has to be Chinese, means you have to understand that. There's a Japanese grand narrative. The French have a narrative on the great civilization of France. They are the ones who are the successors of the Renaissance, and how they are different than the Germans and different than the British. You better not confuse the Frenchmen to be same as those others, because they don't like it. And British have this narrative that they started democracy and the empire, and they brought civilization to the world, and the English language and royal family, all of that is their narrative. So the narratives exist. Somehow Indians have a kind of allergic reaction to discussing the grand narrative. In other countries, it is talked about and it is discussed very openly. When I launched one book in India International Center 3 years ago, and I was talking about the Indian grand narrative, the big attack from the other speakers was, how dare you give us a narrative? I said, I'm not giving you any narrative. How dare you say we need one? Who cares whether we need one? It's sort of like, almost like I've touched a raw nerve. So I realized I better start talking more about it, you know? Because that's like the psychologist saying, okay, you have said, ouch, so there's something there, you know, I got to uncover that. So Indians have this kind of a thing. Now, narratives are not stable. Narratives get broken and new narrative is formed. So there's an equilibrium of voices, which is kind of the consensus. That's the grand narrative. And then something happens, it falls apart. Maybe the nation will break. Maybe a new narrative will be constituted. So many times this happens in the long life of a nation. Right now, you can see the French grand narrative is being challenged with recent events. French grand narrative is being challenged because French have been very liberal and open in terms among the, at least relative to other Europeans, in terms of diversity and pluralism, and they're very proud of you know, accepting all sorts of things. But now the limits to what they can accept are being questioned and challenged. So the question remains, what will be the future grand narrative of France? Will they be able to assimilate and digest this force that is challenging it and turn them into French? It's called domestication, like you domesticate wild animals or plants. You know, will they domesticate this force and make it French? Or will this force take over? Or will a new equilibrium be created, which we don't know what it'll be? Or will there even be a France? You don't know. Because the challenge is very hard. Now, such challenges have always happened, but now there is something different. The different thing is that, you know, there is a foreign outside France headquarters or nexus from where this challenging narrative is being projected. It's not something within France. If, for instance, the people who are wanting a kind of a different status of Islam in France were not connected with people in Iraq or somewhere else, Syria or wherever, then, you know, it would be a domestic problem. And then it would be easier for them to reconcile, figure out, negotiate, make everybody happy, and everybody's life would go on. But to negotiate with the opponent, the French would have to really negotiate with people who are sitting in another country. And that's not an easy thing to do. When the challenge to your grand narrative comes from a headquarters elsewhere, it's a whole different thing. And that is the global era. The reality of the global era is that every nation has got some links with others elsewhere. So the narratives are also in competition on a global scale. You are being threatened, undermined, challenged by narratives based somewhere else. You don't have any control over them. You can't sit at the same table and talk to them and work it out. So the grand narrative issue becoming more complex. Now I'll talk about India. The Indian grand narrative is, there are multiple narratives depending on who you talk to. So there is this, you know, there is this Hinduism grand narrative. There is, and that also is questionable, what is Hinduism, you know, whose idea of Hinduism? Also you can discuss. Then there is There are people who see that British came and created this grand narrative of we are civilizing you, a very anglicized Macaulay kind of grand narrative that they wanted to have it with India. And then the movement that wanted to throw those out, some felt that we should go back to the Mughal era. That was the ideal narrative for us. The Mughals kept everybody happy. So there is that kind of a narrative. Then there is this narrative which says that economic development, forget identity, forget history, forget culture, but just, you know, have high GDP growth rate and, you know, material prosperity is the grand narrative. So there are competing narratives, grand narratives that are in India. Now, now I'll come to my topic, which is Hinduism. The situation I see about India's grand narrative is that what we lack a public consensus of enough people or almost enough people. There'll always be some dissidents, dissenting voices. But what India doesn't have is a clearly stated, clearly articulated grand narrative which everybody can proudly state, such that most people, with rare exceptions, will say, yes, that's who I am, that's the country I belong to. There is a lot of concern, if I say it, maybe I'll get in trouble. If I say it, it's not politically correct, people will accuse me, they will brand me. Privately, aapko main ye bol deta hoon, but publicly, please don't quote me, batana mat kisi ko, like that kind of a talk. Okay, so there is that kind of a anxiety. I think Indians have a grand narrative anxiety, kind of, or maybe some kind of a grand narrative complex that says maybe, you know, there's something wrong with it. Because, and then there is the people from postmodern studies, postmodernist theorists, who are saying that all grand narratives are inherently violent. And that's based on the experience of what happened in Europe, that grand narratives tend to oppress, colonize, make people into slaves. So the very strong, chauvinistic, hyper-masculine kind of grand narrative has that problem. But I would contend that maybe that's not necessarily the case with every grand narrative. That may be the case with some grand narratives, but we certainly need a unity, some kind of a sense of who we are. The opposite of having a grand narrative would be fragmentation. Fragmentation meaning that there's a lot of vote banks, a lot of identity politics. Everybody's got their own micro narrative rather than grand narrative, a sort of tiny narrative. And these narratives are fighting each other. Because to get votes from a vote bank, if I am the person who wants to make my career from a certain community, I have to convince them that you have been oppressed, you are the victims of other Indians, and I have to create a history which fits that. I have to create a history, I have to hire historians, and I have to say, okay, why don't you pump out some history and all that, which will show the oppression of these people by others, because the more oppressed, the more victim they are feeling, the more they'll need me because I'm the savior. So this business of identity politics depends on creating conflicting narratives. So in India, we have entered the age of identity politics and vote banking. That's reality. And I think that has to do with the parliamentary system, because in a parliamentary system, you don't elect the government directly. You elect your member of parliament, and then these 500 odd people collectively vote for the government. Whereas you could have other kinds of democracies that exist where you directly vote for a government, and then the fragmentation of the parliament is not a material factor. You can still have a stable government even though you have a very diverse parliament. But given we have this constitution, and therefore it encourages vote bank politics, and vote bank politics requires kind of fragmented historical narratives. And so there's a whole cottage industry of historians and scholars who are constantly supplying and feeding these fragmented, conflicting narratives and saying one kind of group versus another going on, which you all are very familiar with. So the question is, if the fragmentation is bad, then also the very homogeneous narrative is also bad. Homogeneous narrative would have no room for diversity, would have no room for people having their own way. Would have no room for change and dissent and argument. So it would be a very totalitarian kind of state, like a communist state or some kind of a totalitarian state. And that is, of course, undesirable and would never work. People would never accept it. So both those extremes are undesirable. The extreme where there is one homogeneous narrative for everybody forced on you, is not desirable, won't work, and the other extreme where there's no grand narrative, nothing holding us together, except very practical reality that we get the same smartphones and we have +91 uniting us and things like that. So those are very feeble. They're not very robust things, and we have cricket team and whatnot. Sometimes they're doing well also. So what is there in the middle? So the moment you use the word Hindu, then, you know, people already have some very strong ideas one way or the other, and it tends to polarize. So let me sort of put that aside for a little more time, but I will describe what I'll tell you later on. I will call this Hindu, but I'm not calling it yet, okay? Because I want you to understand it with an open mind. So in this book, Indra's Net, I described a concept called open architecture. Open architecture, like a network, where a network like the internet, where there's lots of players, they relate to each other, they leave each other alone. You can set up your own, and it has nothing to do with me, and you can be on your own, creating your own content. I can be creating my own content. But there are certain rules, like we can't bring down each other. There are certain rules of good citizenship in the network network, that you cannot undermine the others. You cannot sabotage. So long as I respect your right to be different, I have a right to be how I am. So long as I respect that you are not like me, and I'm not trying to convert you to be like me. I have no interest to convert you. You are worshipping the way you worship, and your culture is like it is, your language is like it is, and I leave you alone, and I'm happy with that. But I want the same in respect in return. I call this the principle of mutual respect. Mutual respect. And in the Jaipur Literary Festival, I was on the final debate. They have a huge debate on the last day, about 8,000-10,000 people there. And so there was one Suhail Seth. He's this very guy in a guy. Yeah, you know him. So I had a little nice debate, kind of encounter with him. You should watch that video. So he says, "Aapki baat." One thing I'll want to correct you is that your idea of mutual respect is good idea, but I don't want it to be mutual. I want that. Why should it be mutual? Mutual shows that I want his respect. Why do I need his respect? It should be unconditional. So that's a very common naive view I hear a lot. Then I told him, if you are giving unconditional respect, you would have to respect Bin Laden, you would have to respect Hitler, you would have to respect those who don't respect others. So the only condition I have for offering you respect is that you must offer the same respect to others, and therefore I'm going to respect you. If you don't offer the respect to others, I will not offer you my respect. That is so he kind of accepted that. This idea of mutual respect, I've utilized, and it's matured over a long, long time. After September 11, 2001, when there was all this in New York and Washington, all these attacks and so on, the Pakistani-American community was very shaken up, because there's a lot of unfortunate incidents. You know, people were attacking Muslims, and they were attacking Sikhs just because they're turban. There are these things happening in America. People got crazy. So there was a bhai-bhai moment between Pakistanis and Indians. So I was in Dallas, giving my lecture tour. And then I was invited to a radio station run by a Pakistani. And I went to the radio station, and I gave my talk on the importance of mutual respect. They asked me, "What is your philosophy in the light of 9/11 for American society?" I said, "In my tradition, we have mutual respect. You can worship your way, you can have your deity, you can not worship at all. You know, the point is, I respect that as long as you respect me for what I'm doing." So everybody, there was a talk show. So one lady, who later I was told is a very prominent Pakistani activist. So she called, and he said, "Rajiv Bhai, welcome to Dallas. I'm so happy to hear your mutual respect. On behalf of the Pakistani community, I want to tell you, we also believe in mutual respect, and this is a great principle." So I said, "Wonderful. I'm so happy to hear you say that. But let me tell you what my tradition is, and then you know that is what you're respecting. So my tradition allows me to worship images if I want to. My tradition says we can also worship the Supreme Divine as feminine, as goddess. My tradition also has reincarnation. So I'm glad you respect all that. She quickly hung up. Yeah. You see, sometimes this mutual respect can be a sham. Unless you tell the person, this is what is specific. Now, I have no problem respecting you, whatever it is. I don't want to hang out. I'll say, fine, you do it this way, that way, it's fine with me. But I do it my way. Are you willing to respect me also? Is it reciprocal? So this is how the principle of mutual respect also allows you. If you are sure that you can live up to that standard, then you can demand the other person also. And you'll find that it will really, many people have not really thought through this themselves. They have not thought through this for themselves. Because the principle of mutual respect means, if I respect you, and you reciprocate and say, okay, you also respect me, then why do you need to convert me? I don't need to convert you. You're happy. I'm happy with the way you are. Why do you have a problem with me? What's wrong? Why can't you just leave me alone? So if you can't leave me alone, then I've caught you, that you are not able to live up to the mutual respect criteria. So it's a nice subtle way to kind of catch them if they are playing this hypocrisy game. So this is sort of my building block is open architecture. I don't think that the Hinduism, as I understand it, is necessarily requiring you to have a personal god or a deity. So when people say they're doing, like there is this theory of rasa, art, and aesthetics, which says secular. So when you ask them what is secular, they're saying there's no personal god involved. However, there is transcendence beyond the ego. So there is a transcendence above the ego. There is a state of consciousness they acknowledge where it is not this normal small ego present, but a kind of a consciousness is awakened to a higher expansive state. But there is no presence of a god. Now, you can call it anything you want, but that's wonderful. I mean, there is nothing that says that in a higher state of consciousness, as a result of meditation, you have to see a deity X or a Y, a particular deity or any deity at all. So my idea has enough bandwidth that it accommodates that. Or you could be a person who says there is no transcendent state. With deity, without deity, there is no transcendent state. We are this. This is the normal state. This is the ultimate state. When we are dead, finished, and there is nothing else beyond it. And that's also fine. So the what I call the open architecture is sufficiently fluid, sufficiently flexible, that it accommodates wide diversity. The problem comes from the other side. Some members from some of the faiths or some of the traditions from the other side may not want to respect this kind of an idea. It's too scary. It's too broad. It's too open. Yeah, it's too flexible. And they would like to have something defined, contained, one truth, one God, one this, that, you know. So the problem isn't that I am limited and narrow, although I may be accused of it and branded that way because people are not able to handle this. The point is, I'm willing to offer in the spirit of mutual respect and under the principle of open architecture, I'm willing to accommodate whosoever wants to be a member, as long as they are offering the same to us. So this is, I think, a fair proposition, and you can call it what you want to. I happen to call it Hinduism, because Hinduism is a modern name, but for a tradition which is very old. So if you change your name, doesn't mean that you didn't exist before. So the argument, this argument that Hinduism didn't, the name didn't exist, is useless, silly, it is irrelevant, because we're not arguing how you name something, we're arguing whether that entity existed. And as long as that entity has existed for a very, very long time and has had this open architecture quality, you know. So the term Indra's net I used for the title of this latest book. Indra's net is a metaphor used in Buddhism quite a lot. Indra's net, it from Buddhism, the Westerners have brought it into many Western scientific models and social models. It means that interdependency, a network of interdependencies. So people in quantum physics talk about the cosmos is Indra's net. That's a kind of metaphor that's been used. There are some social theories, and so on, ecosystem kind of theories that use the idea of Indra's net. And most of the time when you ask people where does this, what is Indra's net as a metaphor, they'll say it's a Buddhist concept. So I started doing research because I know Indra is a Vedic deity. So I started doing research and I found out that the Avtamsak Sutra, which is a Buddhist sutra, is where this Indra's net is referenced. And from and that's a, it's been translated into Chinese, and from China it went to Japan and various places. And so that's how the Buddhist idea of Indra's net has spread. But I wanted to know, what does that sutra have to say? The Buddhist people, what do they have to say? The, what are they referring to? And in that, it's a Sanskrit text translated. In that, it refers to the Vedic reference, where it is where somebody asks, what is the nature of all reality? And the answer is that there is a net that Indra has made of jewels, infinite net of jewels in all directions. And these jewels are such that when you look at any one jewel, it will give you a reflection of all the other jewels. So each jewel is a reflection of all the other jewels, which means that each of you is it contains a reflection of all the others. Each particle, each little, you know, fly, each flower, the clouds, everything that exists basically contains some, in some sense, it contains everything else in the cosmos. The whole cosmos is create is contained in every little part of it. This kind of an idea. So this is a metaphor of what is reality. So the whole idea of this open architecture, the interdependency, the flexibility is contained in that tradition. So this is how old this kind of metaphor goes. And right now it is quoted in social theory and so on as a sort of very late, new current kind of modern idea, postmodern idea of how diversity can coexist. So this is my reason for using the term Hinduism, which is a new term for a very old system. So with that, I'll stop and look forward to some comments, and then we'll continue the discussion. Thank you.
So we can have each of the panelists respond to what Rajiv Ji has shared with us. And then I think Rajiv Ji will respond perhaps to what they have to share. And so a little bit of discussion around that. And then I would like the discussion to extend here after that, and whatever you want to ask, clarify, argue, please do that. So what do I do? Well, let's not keep it like this. Let's begin with Professor Poonam Bhadra.
I think the first question that comes to my mind as I hear you speak, and something that you started with yourself, which is really, what do we mean when we say the Indian grand narrative? Actually, it doesn't say the grand Indian narrative here. It says the Indian grand narrative. So what do we really mean? When we use the word Indian, I mean, what kind of an image does it conjure up? Does it, is it a geographical entity? Is it a psychological entity? I mean, what does the term Indian really evoke as an image? I think is a question that is fairly valid, because we have such tremendous diversity. And although I heard you saying that diversity, which talks of how, you know, diversity sort of coexists, is a postmodern concept, I'm not quite sure, can we really call it a postmodern concept? Because for India, it's a lived reality ever since we were born. I do not see anybody in India saying that we were not diverse, that there was a time when we were homogeneous. So I think diversity is as old as India and the civilization of India. So I'm not sure whether we mean that diversity coexists is a postmodern phenomena. I don't know whether that's what you meant, but certainly today in India, we are at a position where we seem to have forgotten that diversity is a lived reality, and we need to speak about diversity. And there's a time when we lived it very naturally. But today we seem to be wanting to speak about it. We seem to be saying, we are diverse. Hey, are you listening? We are diverse. You know, we seem to be wanting to say that. I'm wondering why. I'm just wondering, why do we feel the need when, you know, my mother, who's now 92 years old, and she sees a film, Amrita Pritham's Pinjar, that's based on Amrita Pritham's story novel, and she says, you know, there was really no difference in the way we dressed, whether it was a Muslim family or a Hindu family. We used to wear very similar kind of dresses, ornaments, and things. There was no distinction, but today actually we are looking at these distinctions as something that probably you referred to it also in the sense of identity politics, which I think is something that has played out. And I quite agree with you that this is something that has emerged over the years, you know, having the legacy of the British colonial sort of divide and rule kind of policy, and we've carried it on. It's not that our people looked at it any differently. I would like to just sort of focus upon a few aspects which I seem to have gathered from some of the writings of great Indian thinkers that I have been able to understand, and specifically in the current context. And I hope that that will evoke some fresh questions in our mind as we discuss the whole idea of this narrative. To me, the real Indian narrative is the narrative of diversity and the fact that it's a lived reality. It's interesting that in the Constitution of India, we have a word called fraternity, but we rarely speak about it. We speak about equality, we speak about democracy, we speak about liberty, but very rarely do we look at the term fraternity, and which I think is probably the most characteristic aspect of our society. And I'm reminded of Ambedkar. Ambedkar made a very interesting distinction when he was, you know, debating what should go into the Indian Constitution, is that while we have achieved one man, one vote, which is the political system of democracy, so every man's vote counts, but we haven't achieved one man, one value. So in a sense, he cautioned us that as far as the social democracy goes, we don't have it. We've been able to put in place a political system of democracy with one man and one vote, but he cautioned us that till we do not have one man, one value, our political democracy will also be at peril. And sure enough, we can see that it's happening. I'd like to now just come to a couple of things that I think can be drawn upon from Vivekananda and Vivekananda's writings, which have made sort of world history in one sense. Obama also talked about it when he came here to India. It was Vivekananda actually who spoke about the spiritual and the secular education of the nation. Very interesting. He cautioned us against what he called the dualistic perception, the tendency to look at things in dichotomies, you know? So I would say the tendency to look at the West and the East also would be one such dichotomy. He cautioned us against a dichotomist way of looking at things. He cautioned us against a conditioned functioning of the mind, very clearly so. Post-Renaissance, one of the most significant achievements of human civilization is reason, is the ability to actually logically argue, to develop reason, to be able to reason things. But Vivekananda cautioned that actually reason is one instrument of gaining knowledge, but not the only instrument. In fact, he talked of instinct as the lowest instrument, and then comes reason, after which he calls the third instrument of knowledge, which he refers to as inspiration. So surely this is something that we need to look at very carefully. Reason is itself capable of becoming unreasonable. That is what he cautioned us against. And I think that's what tends to happen when we are talking about a diverse kind of a world, which is totally interdependent. Today in a globalization kind of era, actually, we can't talk of just the Indian or just the US or just a country. We are in a globalized world. So there's more and more interdependence that is demanded of us as civilizations. And I think this is something that really struck me. Interestingly, Vivekanand spoke about the goal of education being where we control both the external and the internal. Now, he talked of, you know, the fact that anybody could do this either by work, by worship, by psychic control or philosophy, by one or more or all of these and be free. Which means that getting into immersing yourself in work itself is meditation or can be meditation. The idea he was trying to say is that we need to control the inner. It's not just the external that we're looking at, which is what comes from the post-Renaissance development all over the world, where we're conquering nature. But he was talking about the inner and the need to conquer the inner. And that is also peculiar to Hinduism, I would say. But we need to expand this idea to mean, is it really something that is so peculiar only to the wisdom and the knowledges that come from within the Indian subcontinent, can we say? Or is this something that many people have grappled with all across the world? And I think that's the kind of thing that we need to understand, rather than identify ourselves as somebody distinct, unique, superior, having a civilization which no one else ever thought about. I think we have learned from each other. I think we have benefited a lot from the different kinds of people who have inhabited the subcontinent called India. And Vivekanand says, this is the whole of religion. Doctrines or dogmas or rituals or books or temples or forms are but secondary details. The point is that somewhere we seem to have conflated this whole idea of inspiration as an instrument of knowledge. And then he talks of a higher ideal, which is that of spirituality. Today we seem to have conflated spirituality with organized religion. And I think we need to make a distinction between the two. The narrative of India, I think, lies in that deeper sense of inspiration and spirituality, rather than in a kind of organized religion, which some people tend to conflate. And I think Rajiv's work probably shows that this itself is a fallacy. And I think we need to be very careful about that. Because once again, we seem to be coming to giving far more, weight to that which is the overt rather than that which is the inner. I'd also like to, say just one more thing about Vivekananda when he talks about truth. Truth, he says, is nobody's property. No race, no individual, no faith can lay exclusive claim. Truth is the nature of all souls. So when he talks of purity and morality, that morality and purity is associated with the control of the mind. It's not about behavior. It's not about social norms. It's not about the way we need to behave as a civilization. It's something much deeper. It's something to do with how we look at each other as part of a cosmos that is connected. Let me come to Aurobindo, Sri Aurobindo, and I'm sure Monica is going to give us far more depth in that. It's been a subject of her area of research and a lot of, I would say, lived reality for Monica. But the purpose of education, in terms of what Aurobindo talks about, is both collective and individual. And he was very, very interested in looking at the relationship between the individual and society. And I think that also is something which is very deep to our tradition. So the point I'm trying to say is, and to quote Aurobindo, the individual exists not in himself alone, but in the collectivity. The free use of our liberty includes also the liberation of others and of mankind. So, you know, there's an echo of Gandhi's Swaraj when he talks of liberating ourselves from the British. It's a much deeper idea of Swaraj, that we need to liberate ourselves, what he calls probably, from the fetters that incarcerate our inner selves. And anybody who's nationalistic, at that time we were talking of Tagore, Gandhi, Vivekanand, Aurobindo, who were trying to break away from the colonial system of education and give us a different way of educating our people. And this was the central idea. Coming a little closer to more contemporary history, Krishnamurti's central idea was an idea of transformation. Transformation of the individual consciousness. And that is what he said was education. That regards relationship as the basis of human existence. Now that's another very interesting idea. If you regard yourself as part of the larger whole, you know, the idea that you were talking about in Indira's net, it's the scientists call something called the hologram, right? Which has a part of the whole, and the whole is in each part, so to speak. But what is important is the relationship along these. And the process of education, according to Krishnamurti, must include an understanding of deep cultivation of psychological processes as much as academic excellence. So education must help students to recognize and break down in themselves all social distinctions and prejudices and discourage the acquisitive pursuit of power and domination. Now these are our thinkers, and I think if you look at the concept of Hinduism, you'll find a diversity of ideas that bring on the plate of Hinduism. I do not think we can define Hinduism and anchor it in one kind of a mold. It's so important for us to fall back to our philosophers, to fall back to our wisdom, in order to understand that really the power of India lies in shifting our gaze to the inner, because for us, the greatest form of knowledge was controlling the inner, and then to see the relationship of the inner with the outer. This is the difference, perhaps, between the narratives that come from developed and so-called Western societies. But my last word of caution would be that we mustn't fall into the trap of dichotomies by comparing the West with the East, because this is a trap of the post-Renaissance Enlightenment period. And I think we need to go beyond reason and yet not ignore reason and make it a part of our pursuit for harmony, love, and peace in society. Thank you. What Ambedkar meant was that since we have such a hierarchicized society, you have people who've been marginalized. He was a Dalit, so he was speaking for Dalits specifically. So what he said is that socially, everyone is not equal. Everyone is not treated equally. So that's what he meant. We don't have one man, one value.
I want to share a few of my related ideas on what Rajesh spoke. I think when we look at self psychologically, what comes across is that self is just like a stream of water. You know, it's just like a stream of water, and from the moment you are born, and you know, as you grow and develop, you come across various perspectives. You know, from your family, from your school, from you know your own culture, from different cultures, and it's very interesting that, you know, when you come across these perspectives, you start using these perspectives to define and structure yourself. So someone who's a Marxist, can explain a lot on the basis of Marxism. Someone who's a psychoanalyst can explain everything on the basis of psychoanalysis, you know? And so on and so forth. So what we really, I think, need to keep in mind as people who wish to evolve is that limiting ourselves, you know, though we all can have our own favorite perspectives, and that comes from our own life experiences, that some perspectives strike a greater chord with us and some simply don't. And, you know, it's different for different people. But we should not, you know, limit ourselves to just accepting our perspective as the reality, you know. So because, you know, we need to kind of, you know, we need to have our own perspectives, fine, but we need to look at all other perspectives with a very, very open mind, you know. And I think so, it's very important in this context that we look at our own, heritage and our own culture also with an open mind, you know, from the mind of a student, you know, not from what has been taught to us by our own people or from cultures outside. So it's very important to have this first-hand experience. Secondly, I'd also like to share something about what is called, because when these interpretations are given to us, it is said that this is scientific, this is not scientific, and that's scientific, and that's not scientific. Now, scientific inquiry can be a very, very tricky thing, you know, because at times the assumptions and the presumptions and the perspective you start with, what you get in the end is really linked to that perspective, you know. To give you two examples, you know, like if I were to measure everyone's blood pressure in this room, I'll get different kind of ratings. You know, someone will have it more, someone will have it less. But can I then simply conclude that this room is just blood pressure? No. You are people and you have a reading that's called blood pressure. So it's a huge error when, say a Western psychologist or a psychoanalyst looks at the narrative of goddess Kali and says that Kali is a phallic mother, you know. Now, for people who may not be aware of that terminology, phallic mother is a Western psychoanalytical concept where it is said that the child is scared of an aggressive and a sexual mother, you know. So when someone may look at Kali, she has that aggression in her, of course. So goddess Kali has aggression, but it does not mean that, you know, A is equal to B, that goddess Kali is equal to aggression is equal to the phallic mother. No, it will be the same kind of error if I were to say that this room is equal to blood pressure. It's not, you know. So we need to be very, very open about, and we need to really look at what is scientific inquiry and how are we doing it, and how are others doing it. Then I think Rajivji also spoke about, this grand narrative. What I would say is that, every culture has its narrative, and every culture does need a narrative, you know. We probably don't need a grand narrative, and one should not have a grand narrative, but every culture needs a good enough narrative, you know, which means that every culture can look at certain strengths in its own self and can also look at certain weaknesses in its own self. Because that's very, very important, you know, for the person's development. Because what happens is when we are born in a culture, you know, we already have that culture in us, you know, by certain heritage and as we grow up. So we are already into that culture, and if we don't have a good enough narrative of that culture, it leads to a lot of conflict and vacuum, which really is, you know, very evident in the kind of psychological conflicts and problems, you know, that the Indian population is facing. Because, you know, they come up with such very strange things, you know. To give you one or two examples, like one patient of mine, he also had a medical illness. So he once came and said that someone, I went to a, you know, very qualified Ayurvedic doctor who said that, you know, your problem has a cure over here. I got those medicines, but I'm not taking them because I have a doubt. Now, if you look at this thing, this speaks of a conflict in the person. You know, you are born here and you have a certain sense that Ayurveda can be helpful. But you also have this sense, because you are conflicted in your own cultural narrative, that it's probably too primitive, it's too unscientific. So you cannot really make up your mind, you know. And similarly, you know, so this whole thing that when you are born in certain culture, it's like this, you know, to have a crippled cultural narrative is like to be born like a child who is born into the family of, you know, criminals, you know, who looks up at his family and says that, oh my God, they are criminals, you know, and I belong to this family, you know. So it is very important that we need to have a good enough narrative for ourselves, because that will help us sort out, you know, various conflicts, and it will also kind of, you know, take forward our like, you know, development. One last point, because I often think of this thing that, you know, that many cultures have been exposed to, you know, say the Western invasion or the colonial, you know, past, and each country and culture has responded very differently of how they have taken it and what they are doing with it now. I think what happened, you know, I think what probably happened in our context is also that due to this colonial rule, at least some of the Indians, you know, I'll not say all of the Indians, but at least some of the Indians, you know, there's this particular, you know, process in psychology, which we call identification with the aggressor, you know, and it's commonly seen in places where someone, you know, like is abused by someone. So what happens is that rather than feeling the pain and anger and rising up against that person, the person starts idolizing that person. I think that that's, you know, probably something that has happened with a large majority of Indians, that rather than, you know, feeling, you know, that pain and anger towards, you know, this, you know, colonial thing and coming to terms with it and, you know, then seeing it objectively in terms of, you know, what good and what bad it did to you, they go on to a very blanket idealization of the whole thing. And I think that that also creates a kind of a conflict in their mind, you know. So thank you so much. That's what I had to share.
I have a very small point to make, and that is about family life. I'm not sure how many of you are aware of the fact that there was an Indian couple in Norway, and there continue to be issues with several other parents whose children were taken away from them. One of the cases was where a child was taken away by the Norwegian child care services because of the fact that the child was given crocin by the mother. As per Norwegian law, you're not allowed to give children medication without the prescription of a Norwegian doctor. The first case, which was much larger and which received a lot of media attention, was the fact that Sagarika and her husband, he was an engineer, lost their custody of their children. Not only was the three-year-old and the 19-month-old son and daughter moved out of their home, they were also separated because of the fact that since they had both been brought up under family circumstances that were considered abnormal, and the criteria for labeling them abnormal was that the children sleep with the parents, the child is force-fed, which is, what evidence was that? That chammach se, katori se, khana khilate hain 3 saal ke bachche ko. I hope all of you understand Hindi. My point, the reason why I am choosing to speak about the family is because that is the area in which I work. And I sort of want to take Pulkit's point further and link it to, you know, what Poonam said and what Rajiv ji said earlier. I think we do need a sufficiently grand narrative to give the self-respect to Indians who are living in other parts of the world. If the way in which Indians are brought up is seen as psychoanalysis included, that you are insecurely attached, correct me if I'm wrong, as far as Bowlby and Mary Ainsworth are concerned, maybe some of you have studied their work. You're considered insecurely attached if you have not had a robust attachment as an infant with a single mother. How many of us have had the benefit of having more than one mothers, fathers, grandfathers, and so on? So by definition, Western psychology has created, without necessarily saying that because of politeness, they have created a problem by labeling Indian family system as pathological, not by directly saying that. So, you know, it is not a question of tolerance. And one of the great things that Rajiv ji, I have been inspired and I've used your quote very often, is that it is not about tolerance. I think you give an example in your book, which I had the pleasure of reading last year, was that how would you feel if you told your husband that, you know, I will tolerate you for the rest of my life? I think we would be divorced by the end of the day. So it's not about tolerating. And now that Indian families are traveling all over the world, I think one of the key issues where we need self-respect returned to us is the ways in which we live, what we eat, what we wear, how we bring up our children, how we speak. For example, I don't think, see, I eat Hindu, I walk Hindu, I talk Hindu, but I don't pray Hindu. So there, it is not, for me, it is not a religious issue. And I told Sunita, I had a statutory warning attached. I will come to the talk as long as I'm not expected to be religiously inclined. Right? But I do think that the ways in which Indians live receive a lot of flack when we travel to other parts of the world. One of my students in Canada had wrote to me because she did not know how to answer her colleagues when they said, "You were still living with your parents?" As if she was some kind of peculiar creature. I think we need the world to know how we live, why we live. Many of the decisions are economic in nature, not necessarily sentimental. And then some are sentimental in nature, and why not? So thank you very much. I'm not going to go on much longer.
Thank you, Nandita. Okay, so Kev.
Good afternoon, everyone. Feel a little strange in saying that I'm one of those who have a grand narrative anxiety and perhaps even a grand narrative phobia. It's difficult for me to think of a grand narrative that is not oppressive to certain people. The narrative of who we are as Indians, for example, where did our religion or where did Hinduism come from? The Dalits claim that they were the original inhabitants. Some Dalits claim that, starting with Jyotiba Phule, and then the Aryans were the migrants, and through various means, perhaps more sociological and economic rather than military, the Dalits became the oppressed class. So that's the opposing narrative to the other narrative, which says that the Hindus are always here. And India has always been the homeland of the Vedas and so on. So which of these two narratives is true, and how can we reconcile these two narratives without doing violence to one of them? Recently, I had an amusing experience when I read the version of the telling of the Ramayana by Periyar, the Tamil politician and leader. And he has a totally different understanding of the Ramayana from what we hear in North India. It is Ravan who is the hero, and it is Ram who is the villain. And he raises interesting questions about why was Shurpanakha mutilated by Lakshman? She was merely expressing her desire. So what is this North Indian story, according to Periyar, saying about women who express their desire, should their noses be cut off? Is that the way they should be treated? And Periyar uses it for his own political aims, because he was active in a time when India was soon to get independence, and there was a demand for a Tamil land which would be different from the North Indian part of India. So he tries to show that the Ramayana is an example of North Indian oppression over the Tamilians, which has continued, which has gone on for 2,000, 3,000 years. So here are two competing grand narratives of about which, and the second one, the Periyar narrative, is something most of us have not heard about. And his particular book has been banned in Uttar Pradesh about 5 times. The ban has been lifted and then it's been banned again. So that shows the kind of anxiety that a grand narrative, that the questioning of our grand narrative can evoke in ourselves. So I would have difficulty in coming to a grand narrative that is grand in the sense that it explains everything, and yet it does not, and yet it does not do injustice to certain people. The other point I wanted to make, there are two other points I wanted to make. One was that this idea about Hinduism. Now, my primary interest academically has been Hinduism for many years, and to some extent also personally. And people find, people are often surprised when they say that you're a Muslim, or at least you have a Muslim name, and you're interested in these kind of things. But as Rajivji was speaking, I was wondering, isn't a grand narrative itself un-Hindu? The term Hinduism, as we have just discussed, is not more than perhaps 300 years old. If I'm not wrong, Ram Mohan Roy uses it the first time in 1813 or so. And so isn't it a part of being Hindu that there isn't one defining narrative of who I am and of who you are and of who we are as a culture, and that there can be different narratives? One of my teachers, a scholar by the name of Julius Lippner, has an interesting theory about this. And he's giving, he's in a way giving a minimalistic narrative about the lack of narrative in Hinduism. And he says that, we talked about Indra's net. He talks about the banyan tree. And he says that, I go to the botanical garden in Calcutta and I see a banyan tree which is at least 5 or 6 centuries old, and I cannot locate where its trunk is, because all its branches come back to the ground, they go underground, and it looks like each of them is a trunk. And each of them is very big and very fat. So when I stand in front of one of these branches, it looks like this is the trunk, and the rest of the branches are coming out from here. But then I walk 5 feet and I see another branch which is also rooted, and it looks like this is the trunk, this is the center of the tree, and the others are offshoots from here. And he suggests, and I tend to agree with him, that isn't one of the gifts of what we call Hinduism the fact that it offers us a new way of thinking, where there isn't one truth and there isn't one book or one prophet or one pilgrimage place. If there is, if there's a Kashi, there's an Uttar Kashi and there's a Dakshin Kashi. If there's a Veda, there are 4 Vedas. There's a 5th Veda, which is the Mahabharata, and there's a Tamil Veda, and so on. So I'm wondering if these questions have arisen in the last 2 or 3 decades about what is Hinduism and who invented Hinduism and does Hinduism exist at all. Perhaps we could say that it exists, but does it exist in the same way as all these other narratives of the Christian and the Judaic and the Muslim and also the non-religious ones? Or does it exist in a way that gives us an answer to not sticking to a narrative? Because that to have a narrative is inherently oppressive, as far as I've been able to see. The last thing I want to say is that what is the relationship between truth and narrative? is a narrative just another name for a truth? And as scholars and as human beings, are we on the search for truth, or are we on the search for a narrative which would make us feel better about ourselves, which would make us feel confident and able to confront the West or the whoever we choose to call the other within our country or outside? What are we looking for? Is the narrative necessarily true, or are we going to accept something that is untrue as a narrative? And I think this is important because the quest for pride or the quest for self-confidence can often be used in ways that are ignorant of certain oppressive realities. I'm not sure how to give an example of this without being extremely provocative, but I think I'd like to say that our quest for the truth in some way might intersect and might contradict our quest for a narrative. And what we as scholars set out to do is to look for an understanding which is as close to what actually happened or what is actually happening right now, rather than what we would like to happen or what makes us have a greater sense of faith or confidence. So I will end here, and thank you.
Let me look at this whole issue I have studied Sri Aurobindo in great detail, and he has been one of the people who have spoken about spirituality in India and its importance from Sri Aurobindo's perspective. I'd like to share with you a very personal letter that Sri Aurobindo wrote to his own wife, Mrinalini Devi, where he talked about the five dreams that he had, and this was in 1914. To 1918, he did most of his writings. The first dream that he said was that he wanted a free and a united India. And if you go into Sri Aurobindo's own personal history, in his own spiritual journey, he was very much attached to, you know, the liberation of his motherland. And only after being given an assurance by the divine that his motherland would be free, did he move into spirituality. And in fact, explore spirituality only to free his motherland. You know, so that was his motivation to begin with. And it is interesting that 15th of August is the day that when we got liberated, and he did say that, you know, divine has fulfilled his promise to me. So that was the first, you know, dream that he had. The second, the birthday. The second dream that he had was that at that particular point of time, the people of Asia had lost their cultural confidence, you know, with the Western Enlightenment that had come in. And while he was very much an admirer of Western Enlightenment, having grown up in London and being very much conversant with the kind of traditions of the West and also their importance, he wanted the fact that the inherent spiritual, the cultural genius of people of Asia should also come to fore. And that we have seen that over a period of time that has happened, and there has been a much greater culture confidence in people of Asia. The third dream that he had was that India's gift of spirituality to the world. And he believed that all nations have a soul. There is a kind of a central sort of an inspiration that is there in each culture, and all cultures ought to be able to preserve it. Because that is what, you know, that is their gift to the world. And India being the kind of chaotic, the most, you know, varied, the most, one would say, most religious as well as irreligious kind of places that it has been, it has actually given, it has been a kind of a laboratory where a lot of, we have experienced or experimented with the fact that, you know, how what are the heights to which we can go in terms of consciousness, and the way we can also manifest it on earth. And he does say that when he go, because he did original reading of Vedas, he says that there is a spiritual impulse that originates there. And he, and there have been many zigzag periods. There have been periods of fall, there have been periods of, you know, losing that inspiration. But it has always survived, whether in form of Buddhism or in other forms. It has always survived. The spiritual impulse in India has always survived. And, you know, all the different people, for example, Sikhism was a very interesting synthesis of all the different Muslim, you know, and Hindu traditions of that particular point of time. Similarly, Kabir also tried to synthesize. So there has been a tendency to put together the kinds of, you know, inspirations that India has come up with at different points of time. And this is a gift that one must be able to share with the world. And we have found that, you know, today people are much more open to spirituality. Now, having said that, he also cautioned against the problems of spirituality. He distinguished between what he called the ascetic denial and the material denials. He said that the materialist denies the spirituality, and the spiritual persons, the ascetic spiritual person, denies the fact that there is a reality of suffering and pain in the world and wants to escape to some other worlds. So being a life-affirming, you know, having a life-affirming kind of a perspective, he said you cannot have a kind of spirituality that does not engage with the problems of the world and its suffering. And it must be life-affirming. And if you, even if you looked at, you know, in India, if you looked at any of the traditions in his Foundations of Indian Culture, he talks about it. He says whether it's dance or it's music or it's architecture or various different forms, they have never been complete without in touch, you know, without in touching, so to say, the body of God. One has to be able to touch divinity eventually if one has to be able to experience, you know, something. So even and in this, again, his definition of spirituality is very broad. He says, for example, an honest atheist or a nihilist or an agnostic is better than a, you know, dishonest spiritualist. So he says in evolution, in human evolution, it is very important to celebrate diversity. And it is eventually the authenticity that we have within our being, our beliefs, that is, that that should be somewhere contained. And we, it's not, because the moment we say that, you know, our truth lies somewhere else beyond us, that that moment is a false leap that we are making, that somebody else will decide our reality for us. So an atheist, for example, is grappling with an issue of God, you know, whether God exists in this world or not. And that is a very, very honest search, and that all must be allowed for human evolution. So this is his definition of spirituality, and he says that India has had several different forms of Hinduism in that sense. And also because his tradition was synthetic, we find that, you know, he talked about, for example, mother would tell beautiful stories about Prophet Muhammad or the Buddha. She wrote on Dhammapad. Shravinda talked about Sikhism, all different forms of yoga. And he says that this is, that's his next point that he moves to. He says it's not just about India. It is about creating a world consciousness. It's also about creating international unity. And as far as 1914, he predicted that, you know, for example, European Union will be affected, you know. So he knew, I mean, through his foresight that, you know, these are the organizations that are very important. He, for example, wanted a very, very strong UN and the internationalism to emerge very strongly. And that also brings me to the whole point of the fact that, you know, we cannot talk about our own culture strengths without talking about the strengths of other cultures too. It is a synthetic tradition, and that is the dream of Auroville as well, that, you know, all cultures, it's an experiment where all cultures learn to live in harmony with each other, preserving their own genius, so to say, as well as at the same time, so there is variety, because he calls it the ideal law of social development, that there is variety. And at the same time, there is this variety is something that is held together by spiritual oneness. And that is very, very important. So the variety, while we are very diverse and different from each other, and that needs to be celebrated and that needs to be encouraged, there is also that inherent oneness that holds us together. And as you know, people who are academicians and also people who are discoursing within this, we need to find ways psychologically also as to how to, you know, create that oneness within. And here he also distinguished between, he says, as we go within, as we look at the realms within, we look at our own swadharma and, you know, our own self-mastery, find ways of doing that, one must be able to distinguish between what he calls true subjectivity and false subjectivity. He says false subjectivity is ego-based. And that is something, that kind of a discourse must be avoided. And true subjectivity is inclusive in nature. And that eventually, as we are finding our own truth as Indians in our own diversity, we must be able to also be celebrate the same for the other, and we must be able to include that within our own vision. So that was the fourth dream, and the fifth dream was that we are not the end of evolution, that we are transitional beings, and we must be able to evolve further. You know, we are, our grand narratives are actually not outside, they're written within our own souls, because it should be a kind of a journey. He says, it's a very beautiful sentence in which says that and a person in integral, sadhak of integral yoga, for example, will not rest. He will never say, my guru, my avatar, my country. He said he will never rest till he has found all the truths, a truth in all the truths that exist around him, and be able to harmonize them. So this is the kind of the evolutionary step forward that he looks at. And actually, Indra's net is a beautiful image for that. You know, that one should be able to see oneself and see all, you know, within that as well. And I would say that, you know, as we explore this diversity, it should be our journey within. And the capacity to harmonize, the capacity to look at both the sides, to listen deeply to each other, not just dialogue, but, you know, because when we say dialogue, sometimes we are doing it with our own minds. It's a deep listening to the other that is very, very important, and to create, you know, harmonies of our own soul in a sense, and weave it into our own being as we interact with more and more people. So thank you.
Namaskar. Actually, when Sunit sent me the invitation and the format, I got into deep agitation because he had mentioned Lata Shenawa, TISS Mumbai. The reason for this agitation is I have been, looking for the truth, as they say. And then they say, when you're affiliated to somebody, you're associated to somebody, you cannot be provocative. You know, I can get away with anything. Now, it becomes easier. And if they challenge me, you know, the other day somebody was saying, you know, when somebody in the midst of a discussion, take this, it's on. Can you hear? You're in the midst of a discussion, not an argument. Huh? He says somebody starts calling you Nazi, you're winning the argument. You know, in TIS, for some time, and before that also, I used to work in a parish school for almost 23 years with special children. The agitation is for two reasons. One is that, my interest is not in Hinduism or narratives or whatever, they don't interest me at all. I work with children, children interest me. The woman interests me because children are important across cultures. Now culture, I think out of 46, only 45 have been exterminated, only one remains. Religion came in, I think, in the 7th century, the first time to India, we didn't have religions. And not Raja Ram Mohan Roy in 1830, but the British created it when the census was compiled. So they wanted to separate out the Jains, the Muslims, the Christians from the so-called Hindus. So that's when the coin Hindu was terminated. When the Portuguese came, they used the word gentus. That is still used in some of the records, and this is not from Nagpur or RSS headquarters. They're from the collector's records. There is enough evidence which I can give you references for. So for me, why children? Because children constitute 40 to 45% of the Indian population. Children's happiness used to be very important across cultures. And families in cultures, collectivistic cultures, we now have what Weber's introduced, the methodological individualism that we talk of, where personal gratification, individual attainment is the norm, whereas collectivism believed. You know, in India, we had these very clear two values. Aparigriha and Niram Bhavana, humility, and accumulating what you want. So from contributors to consumers. That's what Max Weber did, or this whole Western narrative that came into us post-colonization. So for me, I don't believe in all these isms, because Marx came to India, never came to India, but he had this statement, you know, after Macaulay's, I've traveled across the breadth and length of India and I've never seen a beggar, I've never seen a thief. And when I made this statement, you know, we were 30% of the world's GDP, around 29-30% in 1750, and then we come down to 1.6%, and people come back and have fights with me, like how Rajiv Ji was saying. And then I show them Angus Madison reports, the OECD reports will tell you this. But Karl Marx says, you know, but it's all right. Whatever their faults may have been and their feudal structures, England had a double mission in India. One was to civilize the pagan, the native, and the second was to lay the material foundation for India. Now, I worked for 23 years. The woman why I said is because in our families, in our culture, collectivistic societies across, Mexicans, whoever. You know, when I was in the US on a Fulbright scholarship for 6 months, I had access to a lot of documentation. Russell Means, the American Indian activist, Ward Churchill, have written a lot about the American Indian genocide. There are white people who've written about the genocide. One of them is Alan Jones. You must read this, Genocide, War Crimes and the West. Read Ward Churchill's chapter on education for extermination. I'm not going into it because, like I said, I get very agitated. One of the reasons is that I've been open to so many versions of this truth, and then putting the links are too much. There's too much that my mind gets into agitation. But one of the things that came across, Russell Means says, I ordinarily detest writing because that is the way the white man has decided to legitimize thinking through an abstraction over a spoken relationship. The 45 cultures that were exterminated were oral traditions. I don't know why we do research. Every day, every second week, I get a paper for reviewing and everything. And this research has been done. 20,000 studies on how harsh parenting is going to cause emotional problems in children. Why are we doing new research? It's just being duplicated. Does anybody know what is written in the Shastras? Can we do Purva Paksha or whatever we are talking about? No. We want to write something that has been written. So when we say, then when I'm, you know, I got introduced to Indian psychology, I invited myself for 5, 6, 7 years. I've been knowing Sunit, and I got introduced to Rajiv Gandhi. Deeply sorry. Rajiv Malhotra, because Rajiv is now Rajiv Malhotra-ji's work. And I could understand a lot of things in connection of the whole digestion theory. You know, there is, the important thing is families were considered cornerstones of society. Families were given the responsibility of raising children. And the woman is the primary caregiver. And today from a culture that celebrated the feminine, we've reached one to that's enslaving the feminine. You know, I'm called very often, the second part of my agitation, I tend to digress a little because there's so much of agitation. The second part of the agitation is 23 years I have worked with mentally challenged children. And you know what's frightening me? Is that the problems that I used to see in my mentally challenged children, I am seeing in the Indian child. This is scary. I hope you'll get agitated by this, Because we have narratives. Who said we don't have a narrative? We do have great narratives. We have two important narratives. So, you know, I used to deal with hyperactivity, learning disability, autism, vitamin D deficiencies, eye-hand motor coordination, digestive disorders. All this I see in our India Shining children today. India Shining, by the way, is about 10 to 12%. And people tell me, you know, you're talking about my research was on the child rearing function of non-slum urban families, okay, urban cities of India. So he said, you're very elitist, you're working with, urban people, rich people, not the Dalit, not the marginalized, not, because that's our narrative today. So I said, what I realized is that the maid who comes to your house, the driver who works with you, the clerk in your office wants to raise his child like you, like my, you know, he wants them to learn English. So from a nation of craftsmen and entrepreneurs, we now are raising a children who will be either a coolie or a security guard or a British sepoy. So you know who the British sepoys are, that's us, the India Shining. The security guards, why? Because one Shekhar Gupta told me that, you know, the second highest employable profession today in India is security guards. It's frightening. 85% kind of go into that. And the clerks, of course, the one who cannot get into the fancy college where English is being spoken, this is what the agenda is. So when I'm talking of nine-year-olds coming to me with vitamin D deficiency because they are moving from an air-conditioned home to an air-conditioned lobby, to an air-conditioned car, to an air-conditioned school, and horror of all horrors, to an air-conditioned home, play school. You know, this is very, very frightening because we move from a leisure culture to a entertainment culture. So I have parents coming to me, and everybody, all Indians, it's not Dalit, it's not Muslim. I don't know why we get caught in all this, because the Macaulay's success, I think it's the most brilliant war strategy in the world. He just ensured that he take away the education system. You know, in 1750, we had 100,000 schools in each presidency. Read Dharampal's book, who did a 10-year study on Gandhiji's statement at Chatham House about how the beautiful tree perished. Take away her education system, take away her culture, and you will have somebody who will be a slave, who has no pride in his own thing, in his own nation, and you can get him where you want him as your slave. We've succeeded. Because every parent, I mean, I'm invited to BMC school. BMC is, you know, Mumbai, Bombay Municipal Corporation schools. I mean, invited to Dhirubhai Ambani kind of schools. I work with IIT, I work with Tata Institute. Last year I did a session with Delhi University students across everywhere. Children, they want to send their children abroad post the 12th standard. And the BMC schools and the SSC medium schools want to get into a English medium school. You know, this is what Gautam Bhatia interestingly says, that, you know, the governance agenda of all our politicians and leaders, he has this wonderful analogy, which he said, you must read this, what Copenhagen missed. He said, there is Sarla Devi who lives in Kumau village, and she has... her carbon footprint for a year is half a ton. And our governance, our stakeholders in child well-being, whether they're schools, whether they're families, whether they're politicians, I don't call them leaders anymore, is to convert Sarla Devi's life, which is half ton, to Mrs. Kapoor from Noida, whose carbon footprint is about 16 and a half tons, very, very close to the American average, not even of today. You know, this I noticed when my PhD was almost like, they used to tease me like a World Bank study, because my guide made me take 5% of this thing. So I interviewed 1,100 mothers across SES, very big study, and I did 42 stakeholders. So there I found out that, he says, we are in a constant haze, perpetual haze of constant gadget upgrade and foreign international vacation agenda. And this I see everywhere. The moment you get a little money, you want to put your child into something, send them abroad, get a whole lot of gadgets. And this is where I have a problem with the agitation of the first part, is that children I'm dealing with, the, you know, I think Indians are the brightest. I'm not saying this like Mera Bharat Mahan types kind of thing, because seriously, not Mahan. But we're interesting people, we're bright. Not anymore. The kids I meet, I see this great decline in emotional intelligence. I see this great decline in critical inquiry. We used to be a resilient lot. I, you know, a 35-year-old mother told me this. When I asked her, one of the questions in my sample was, you know, 15 years from now, where do you see your daughter? She has a 3-year-old daughter. She said, you know, Lata, my daughter's going to be very bright. She's going to be like CEO types, and she's going to be making fabulous money. But in terms of dealing with her husband, with her servants, with her, you know, with her mother-in-law, with her mother, with her neighbors, it's not going to happen, because we don't teach them these things. These were part of our cultural upbringing. It had nothing to do with your religion. It had nothing to do. So we have only two narratives. One is this, you know, I think we do have narratives. We have this whole academic mafia narrative. No, really, I'm not given the mic at Tata Institute or one of these so-called, you know, because you're so scared what I'll say. You know, what the, you know, what is the result, you know? Dharavi, I think you all must have heard, infamously. Dharavi is this great big slum of Asia. And people are coming to now kind of, you know, there's this great conspiracy kind of, I look at it. And 2 years ago in Tata Institute, there was this thing, you know, Max Planck from Germany. Okay, they are, these are people who, they, I call them the experts. Okay, so now the mother, the father, and the neighborhood, the peer thing, you know, we have this 0 to 6, the child is like, you know, like God, so let him play. 1.5, we start, a child is going for tuitions, phonetic classes, etiquette classes. Then they have the entertainment culture, so the child is taken to the mall, and then there is school, then there is, what do you call, technology. So there is this compensation culture, because I make you, you know, this is what I call child labor. You know, I'm called, you know, for women's empowerment, you know, and everywhere I go, rape, domestic violence. You know what has come out in my thing? 97.3% of women, they could be rich, they could be poor, they could have 5 drivers, they could have, you know, could be a maid servant, could be a politician, could be whatever. Fatigue. That is what ails the Bharatiya Nari. It is not rape, it is not domestic violence, because this is coming from the pathological paradigm, because we've created a service industry. So this narrative, which has taken families and neighborhoods, bring them back. Children are outsourced to the service industry. First, you create a problem. You know, the other day, Obama came and this girl was so excited. She said, you know, he talked of obesity. America faces a problem. America faces a problem with obesity. I'm so excited, I'm to learn. Obesity? Do we have a problem with obesity? Your narrative is based on the West. So my whole connection is the second thing. I'll give you, I'll just end with this Dharavi thing, because it's important, because this is how the service industry has taken over. It's not about countries, it's not about nations, it's about corporations now. So I gave this thing for, it's called, you know, Sadahak Etherak, to bring back the leisure culture. And my son told me it's not going to be taken. You've sent it to Tata Institute. They don't like non-service industry options. I said, just let's get back the play areas that we had. 1 year later, I see Dharavi is all set. We have experts from abroad. We have, you know, and exactly in the play, of course, there are high-rise, but Dharavi contributes 10% to the GDP of Mumbai. They call it an eyesore. It's resilient. They have the cleanest toilets. They have better water than Cuff Parade. It is taking care of 5% of the 85% of, you know, it's all about small-scale workers, entrepreneurships. It's about neighborhoods. And this place is called an eyesore. So you remember Sarla Devi to Mrs. Kapoor of Noida? You know, 16 and a half, this is what you want to do. But who has been bought to get the makeover done? Is experts from France, Netherlands, Germany, USA, evangelists included there. Then there are NGOs working. There are these people. Aesthetics, a few people are shown, but who have all worked abroad. None of those people, the pottery industry people, there are great people like you know, Harish Hande, Rajiv, what's his name, you know, who worked in the field, who worked and created systems, Rajendra Yadav, you know, transformed. I work with, you know, what's his name, very famous person, UTV. Not at all. UTV head honcho, Ronnie Screwvala. I'm part of his group where we work in Mangaon, 100 villages water harvesting. No Hindu, no Muslim, no Christian, no Dalit, everybody works, empowering women. These people were not called to redo the Dharavi. So my point is, you have to get your own narrative. And I'll end with this, you know, this finding for truth, Gandhiji came up with a very important statement. He said, the masses have never, he said, truth by nature is self-evident. As soon as you remove the cobwebs of ignorance that surround it, it shines clear. That is my agenda. But then, you know, Gustave Le Bon, very interesting person, you should read his The Crowd, excellent on crowd behavior, which is happening right now. You know, comedy with Kapil and all that, you know, is our agenda nowadays. The masses have never thirsted after the truth. Whoever can supply them with illusions is easily their master. Whoever attempts to destroy their illusions is always their victim. And the final thing that I'd like to say is Gabriel Garcia Marquez said this very interestingly. You know, I don't know if how many of y'all have read The Autumn of the Patriarch. You must read it. And he says that, you know, you control truth. I don't have the whole thing, but the gist of it is, you know, truth is controlled to such a point that you're being lied to all the time. And when you're being told something, you know, it starts from there. So only after the patriarch comes, history is read. Your narrative is only post the patriarch. So India's narrative is post, you know, the Mughal, the golden Mughal age, you know. So I think we need to, you know, like, I'm not even getting into Aryan invasion theory and all, because they've been debunked, you know. Houses are old as, you know, what is claimed as Aryan invasion, you know, 5,000 years old, you know, structures. So I think looking for the truth, it's important, I think, for all of us to have our own narratives, because once you unveil the cobwebs of ignorance, truth triumphs, I think. So that's like kind of my understanding of a narrative. Thank you.
Since time is short, I'm going to focus on just a few main points. Not that the others aren't important, but where I think I can add the maximum value. So what Gaiji said is very interesting, and I want to definitely discuss that, because it relates, these are some of the issues he raised, are very, very important. And my earlier book, Being Different, addresses these very issues. So I want to mention a few. I differentiate the Dharma traditions from the Western and the Abrahamic religions in five or six criteria. Like, we have a different attitude towards what they would call chaos. It's not scary, frightening, evil, that kind of thing. Different relationship. And the idea of an integral unity as opposed to a synthetic unity, these kind of things. But the one point I want to, one point of differentiation I want to bring out, because it relates to what you said. The Abrahamic religions, idea of truth, because you mentioned truth and the narrative, the idea of truth is based on a, what I call history centrism, which means a unique historical event, which is not to be, which is not reproducible. In history, something happens, and the ultimate truth is delivered from the realm of unknown, the otherworldly, the transcendental realm of God. Is from that realm, there is an infinite gap to our realm. I have no access to it. There is no toll-free number or website where I can go log on. And I cannot invoke God or become the prophet or become Christ and achieve that. And so that truth is only accessible if I understand it through the history. Somebody had that truth and conveyed it as a unique messenger. And therefore, my access to that truth is if I know that history, the historical record, the one book, the one event, the one message, the final messenger, this kind of an idea. I call that history centrism. I call it prisoner to history. Therefore, truth is a prisoner to history. And that history happens to be controlled by an institution, always. And therefore, I'm a prisoner to that institution who have the proprietary rights, like Microsoft has for Windows. So they have for that book and how it is to interpret it. So once the cosmology has been accepted that there is the ultimate truth, infinite gap from man, then it follows that the truth can only be delivered by somebody who was selected to come down and deliver the truth. And that happened in history, won't happen again. And therefore that record, which is in the control of an institution, that is my only access. So organized religion follows from that. So if the cosmology is of an infinite gap, then you have the consequence of history centrism and institution centrism. This is what we have a different tradition where every human is Satchitanand, has the Rishi potential, however rarely achieved, but the Rishi potential of achieving the state of consciousness which those people achieved. So every one of us has the potential of access to that truth directly, without access to history, without access to an institution. So this, and therefore if in my tradition I want to say that whatever was achieved by Ramakrishna or by, you know, Sri Krishna or by Arjun, he experienced something, or Sri Aurobindo, I have access to it myself. And so do you, so do you, so do everybody. So I call this, ours is a Adhyatma Vidya, the inner science, and Satchitanand as the essence of every human being, and I call it the Rishi potential. And this is very antithetical to the history-centric religions. So history-centrism leads to absolutism, dogma, one book, don't violate it, blasphemy, final word, obedience. Whereas the Rishi potential philosophy of Adhyatma Vidya, Satchitanand, says, go within and raise your consciousness. Don't worry what he said, he said, he said. You can be a perfectly fine Hindu having never read any text. In fact, Raman Maharshi first experienced these things. Then he found others and said, oh, okay, they are also saying the same thing. And the purpose of the text is simply to give me a guideline what I can feel I can discover for myself. It's more like physics. Because in physics, somebody, Newton, had this apple fall on his head and he came up with gravitation law. Now, if somebody tells me there was no Newton, or Newton was somebody else, not what they think he is, there is no physicist who is bothered. Why are physicists not bothered whether historical Newton existed, whether historical Newton didn't exist? Is because we can replicate the same thing and find it for ourselves. Whether Newton discovered it or not, we can demonstrate it in the lab. Since we can replicate it and demonstrate it in the lab, the historicity of Newton or Einstein is simply incidental. Same way. The claim, we're talking about claims, each religion is a set of claims, that's what it is, and falsifiable. So our faith claims are that there is nothing someone experienced which is not reproducible again, and in principle, by all of us, no matter how difficult. But in the idea that it can be done means I'm free, I'm not dependent on some history-centric event or an institution. And if I read a text of a great Hindu kind of a text, it gives me inspiration, guidance of what I have to ultimately discover and experience for myself. So the self-experiential possibility and the ultimate need that I should experience for myself is very, very important. Therefore, when you talk about what is truth versus what is narrative, the history-centric people have this dilemma. Is it true or is it my narrative? I've been told this by the institution and it is non-reproducible. Either I believe it or I'm considered to be somebody who's rejected it. Hindu can say the narrative you can reject, and if you discover it for yourself, you've discovered something for yourself. So ultimate truth is always self-experienced, and whatever narrative you believe or don't believe, that narrative is just a guideline. It is a raft. The Buddha said, when you cross the river with the raft, you leave the raft behind. You don't carry it on your back and walk around with it. Or when you climb a ladder, you leave the ladder, you don't carry it with you. So all the paths, all the teachings, all the texts are simply the raft or the ladder. And you don't carry it with you, it is not something absolute. This is a very amazing quality we have. Freedom. So I wrote an article called Freedom from History. I think the big religious conflicts in the world are because they are fixated on history, and therefore, since you don't have freedom from history, if your account of history and my account of history are in conflict, we can never resolve it. But in my case, my faith says, fine, we can, as long as we can have the experience, we can, don't need that history. It's just a means to an end. It's not an absolute thing by itself. So this business of history centrism versus the Rishi potential is a very big difference. Now, this, what this leads to is a second point. We have a difference between Shruti and Smriti. So the Shruti is that reality which each of us can discover, and that is the reality. Smriti is a man-made, human-made histories, paths, you know, different sampradayas, different paramparas, all the do's, don'ts, all the conventions, all the dhamma shastras, artha shastras, all of that is smriti. And smriti is relative to a certain time, place and context. And therefore it is changeable. So we don't like this text or that text, or this text is oppressive, or somebody feels that such and such text is doing injustice. We can write a new one. We can write a new one. It is, and Ramayana is an itihas, and that is smriti. Mahabharata is smriti. These are smritis. So today there is a new Kurukshetra. Today, this is called globalization. There's a new Kurukshetra with different forces than the ones that existed in the earlier Kurukshetra. And so the idea of what is dharma, what is adharma, all the debates that happened, we have to have those debates. What is right action for today? So today, so we learn from the past itihas in order to get those morals and lessons and ethics, in order that we have to kind of redo them today rather than blindly copy them. We can't blindly copy them for today. We have to redo our smritis for every time. So the freshness of the smriti for every time and place, and even Manu says you have to revive the smritis and revive them and recontextualize them and don't just follow them blindly, means we have a freedom. Freedom from history, freedom from these texts, freedom from these paths, which I think is an important point, and I'm glad I raised the question so I could answer this. Now, I want to make a few other comments. I think that Professor Sharma said something very nice. We need to feel the pain of colonial oppression rather than the what sort of Stockholm syndrome of sympathizing just to escape the pain so we feel good. I think this is so correct. I see that all over the place. I see that in many debates I'm having in various places, the denial of the issue. People craving, dying to feel good. That sort of the feel good, you can buy, you can do anything as long as you make them feel good. So this is maybe the reason the pop culture comes in so handy in India, because people need that escape. You know? So that I thought was a very nice point. I also liked Nandita Chaudhary's idea of family, the Indian family being pathologized. That is something very important to me, and I would like to, in fact, talk to you later more and learn more, because this is part of my work. What I'm finding is that the West, having broken down their multi-generational families, now very keen to break India's multi-generational families, and you know, this business of individualism going to the extreme that there is no family life left and so on. They are finding that they're having a serious problem because people are living longer because of medical treatment. Their people can live longer and longer, but they have very empty lives. So most of the people who are living longer are on psychiatric drugs. They're being kept to keep alive. So they can say we live longer, but are they happy? You go to they're in old age homes, they've been rejected by their families, and they are living miserably, so they're drugged, so they're not in any trouble. So they're kind of living a nominal life, not really a good human quality life. I know this from experience because I was a hospice worker. 20 years ago, I got trained to be a hospice worker. I went through hospices, you know, people who are dying, terminal, have no family to look after them. So they call up and sign up for hospice, and hospice sends a volunteer like me. And the job of the hospice worker is to be your friend and to be your advisor and to be with you, not a medically, not medical care, but more like psychological and emotional. So I came across a lot of these hospice clients very lonely, abandoned, you know, some daughter living in California would send flowers once every month or wire some money and some person would bring this guy's favorite food, but no company, no sense of belonging. So I think this Indian family system is the sort of thing that they are now looking at as something they have lost and they need to recreate. So people are experimenting with the return to some sort of a sangha. They're creating sangha. There's a Princeton sangha. They're creating this kind of community using Indian spiritual ideas to give company and to give values and so on. So this is, they are pathologizing on the one hand. And on the other hand, they're also doing experiments to cope with their own problem. And many of those experiments are taking our ideas. So it's very interesting that you raised this. Poonamji, I was very interested in your points, very provocative. You made the most provocative points. Just to correct, I did not say that diversity is a postmodern concept. In fact, diversity is the very nature of Indra's net, which is a very old concept. So the diversity is always there. It's not a postmodern concept. Postmodernists have done their own idea of deconstruction. In my book, Being Different, I have criticized postmodernism quite a lot because they have done a deconstruction without some place they're standing from. Because wherever you're standing, they like to deconstruct that also. So it's different from our deconstruction where you're deconstructing the ego, but you are not left in nihilism. You are left in a certain anand. You're left in a state of anand. There is a truth, there is an essence which the postmodernists would deny. So we do have an essence, but it is not a sort of a constructed ego kind of an essence. It's a different sort of an essence. So I like your thing about shifting the gaze to the inner, because if one does that, which is not what the postmodernists ask us to do. So they deconstruct something, but they have nothing to replace it, nothing to substitute in its place. So this is a very big difference between our Dharma traditions and the others. I think the most interesting point that Poonam Bhattaji raised is when we talk about India and its narrative, are we talking about a country in terms of geographical boundary? What are we talking about? And my way of thinking is there's two issues here. One is there is a world view, I would call the Indian world view, which has no geographical limitation. Anybody in the world can accept that view or not accept that view. Like you could be a Marxist or not a Marxist, it has nothing to do with the geography where Karl Marx lived. The Marxist view has a universal claim and people can accept it or reject it. And different religions claim to have a universal applicability, you can accept or reject. Similarly, the Dharma traditions have a universalism that people anywhere can accept if they want to. So the truths we are talking about, the principles we are talking about, looking inward, Indra's net, diversity, Shruti versus Smriti, all the principles that different people here are sharing, that is an Indian narrative. Applicable to an Eskimo, to a Chinese, to a Russian, to an American, to an African, then everybody, if they want, can join the Indian grand narrative in that sense. So there is an Indian grand narrative. Sri Aurobindo's narrative is the Indian grand narrative. Okay? So that's the Indian grand narrative which is not limited to the modern political entity called India. There is that kind of Indian grand narrative. However, there is also another kind of Indian grand narrative which has to do with the political reality of India. As long as there are nation states, as long as the reality of countries with boundaries and limits to what movement of people and geographical resources, natural resources are owned and contained by isolated groups. Somebody got oil, somebody got river water, and if the river moves that way, then they own the water. And as long as the world is partitioned and divided and segmented into nation states, which is reality and going to be during our lives. You have to deal with the fact that there is a political entity called India. There's 1.2 billion people. They have to be looked after. They have to look after their interests. And one cannot be confused between what is and what we do, what is wishful thinking. Our wishful thinking, or prescriptive approach would be that there shouldn't be such a thing. But the descriptive approach of what is real, what exists, is a practical reality, something we have to deal with. So until such time as humanity evolves beyond nation states, and that may not happen in this century, until such time, we have to be practical and say that the people who live in the nation state of India need a narrative so they can all be happy, they can have mutual harmony, and they can maximize the fulfillment of life. And so there has to be an Indian grand narrative also of the political nation of India. There has to be that narrative also, that is true. So there's two Indian grand narrative ideas, and I'm glad you sparked this discussion. And Monica ji, I fully agree with you. Sri Aurobindo is also somebody I read a lot and benefited a lot, and his ideas of India are very much part of what I think is the Indian narrative. And also the idea that this Indian narrative is something grounded, to be grounded in the nation state of India, but it has to expand from here and be offered to the rest of the world. This is an Indian, he mentioned the important role of India in the future of humanity. So there is both a metaphysical Indian grand narrative and a narrative of a particular nation state which can then be expanded to all of humanity. And then Lata ji, I'm very happy that you raised the question very passionately about the colonized minds and how these colonized minds, we give many, many examples, show up in so many different ways, in psychiatry, in child care, and you know, parents and whatnot. So I'm very happy to hear that. So I'll stop with that, because otherwise I won't get my cup of tea to go away. But in any case, I want to just make one or two more final points. That I think the Indian grand narrative is a network of small narratives, like Indra's net of jewels. So you have many, many communities, many ideas organized in a network, relating to each other, fluid, having mutual respect with each other. So it's not one homogeneous, centrally controlled, institutionally or kind of organized religion kind of narrative, but a network of narratives. And the other point I want to make is that a narrative need not be explicit and conscious. It could also be an unconscious narrative. It can be narratives that you are just following them by habit or unconsciously are following them, but you're not explicitly aware of them or publicly stating them. Those are also narratives. Thank you.
My question is to Professor Poonam Batra ji. You talked about collectiveness and equal values. What I fail to understand is why we are the only one who feel the equality, whereas the Western ones are the ones who are feeling exceptional. Why? Why are we putting forward the equality concept, where the Westerners, so-called Westerners, are claiming themselves as exceptional, as Rajiv Mehta sir said. Thank you.
Actually, about the fact that Americans call themselves exceptional is a concept that I don't know. So you would be able to, I mean, I think Rajivji would be able to. But equality, the aspect of equality is a constitutional value of this country. Okay? We are committed to equality. So the question of why doesn't arise. Sure, of course there has to be dialogue. The question I was trying to say, I was just reminding ourselves of Ambedkar when he said that we have a political democracy but we don't have a social democracy. And because we don't have a social democracy, our political democracy will always be in danger. That is the point I was trying to make.
Hi, my question is to Rajiv ji. Sir, why can't Abrahamic traditions accept mutual respect for the sake of world peace? And because it is very important for us also to write Indian grand narrative. Is how geopolitics is played here.
The Abrahamic religions start with the assumption of an infinite gap with God. And the infinite gap with God means that humans don't have access to the ultimate truth. And therefore, when a peygamber or a prophet or a messenger is sent, he sends us, conveys the message that we have no access to. And that creates what I call history centrism, which means that the historicity of that very special once in a whole universal history that event has happened, will never happen again. So that makes that historical moment very important. And whatever has been written about that moment, whether it is Bible, Quran, whatever, that becomes a history-centric, absolute canon, a document without which I can't get truth. So if I can't ever access the truth through my own meditation and reaching a higher state of consciousness like Sri Aurobindo, I can't do that. Because I can only access it through that historical moment which is in that document. Now, the moment you have a faith which is based on history-centric events and history-centric document, that means whatever is violating the document, I have to violate. Whatever contradicts the document, I will not accept. No, whether it is logic, whether it is science, whether it is a question of fraternity, mutuality, whatever it is, if it's written in the document, that's my document because that happened, God said it, I can't change it. Okay, so now this means I'm a prisoner to history-centrism. Okay, if I'm a prisoner to history-centrism, the best I can do to somebody who's different is I can tolerate him. But I can't respect. And in the book, Being Different, the whole chapter is on the difference between tolerance and mutual respect. Tolerance means I tolerate you, I won't kill you, but I know you're going to hell. Yeah. I mean, you're no good, you're false, because according to my book, you know, you're not right. It does, your book is no good according to my book. And it's not a matter of logic, it's not a matter of that. It is absolute, it's fixed, it's closed. And so you are saying something different from this, therefore you're no good. But you know what? You show how patronizing, how nice I am, I tolerate you. Okay. The idea of religious tolerance starts in Europe in the 1700s. Because until then, different kings, see the Holy Roman Empire had broken. Okay? And different Protestant kings in the 1700s and 1800s had their own version of Protestant Christianity. So there was Presbyterian, there was this one, there was Episcopalian, there was Lutheran. So there were different kingdoms, each with one absolute required religion of all their people. So there was no tolerance and no question of respect anyway, but no tolerance for people who were of a faith other than what was dictated by the king in that country. This is Europe was broken into a lot of these countries. And so there were wars. And therefore, a treaty was reached between a couple of kings that I will tolerate the people of your faith to live in my country and you tolerate the people of my faith to live in your country, which means you do not prosecute them. Okay, that doesn't mean you respect them, it just means you will not prosecute them. So this is where the origin of religious tolerance starts. So the word religious tolerance in the European idea is a very big thing, big achievement, because for them it was a very big achievement. We didn't have that problem. We didn't have the problem where a king would say that all the citizens in my kingdom have to be of his faith. The king's own faith is not something he imposes on other people. In fact, there is in the Mahabharata, when a king is being coronated, in the coronation ceremony, his ideal is, O king, be like a garland maker and not a charcoal burner. Garland maker meaning diversity of flowers, all kind of different flowers that you, the king, have strung together into a beautiful garden. So a garden is a symbol of a beautiful harmony among diverse flowers. Charcoal is when you burn all these flowers and they all become black, ash, dead, they all the same and homogeneous. That is charcoal. So your job is to maintain the diversity as a garland maker and do not break them down into a common denominator to make them all the same. That is, then you are a charcoal burner. So he's told, O king, be like a garland maker and not a charcoal burner. Now this idea did not exist in Europe. So they needed this concept of tolerance, that I tolerate you and you tolerate me, but it was not mutual respect. So you see, when you look at what is the cosmological metaphysical starting point of Abrahamic religions, what is the history of them had of wars, religious wars with each other, very fiery wars with each other, and then you look at where things are today, they have evolved over these thousands of years to a point of tolerance, but mutual respect is yet to happen.
In my limited knowledge, the definition of narrative includes a temporal dimension. So how do you think that we can transcend this inherent history centricism or the contradictions about what concepts emerged where and how and which among them are more important than the others? Would you say that there are some criteria that we must constitute as a grand narrative?
So, absolutely correct. The temporality would be in the realm of Smriti, not Shruti. And the transcendence of that, transcendence of context, space, time, is only available in a higher state of consciousness, beyond the ego. So the only universality of truth in the Shruti is available to us in that state of consciousness. So the assumption being that when I am in a position to say that I have seen the ultimate, I no longer have the ego that needs to fight anyway. As long as I'm in the ego that needs to fight, that needs to conflict, that has these fixations of this group versus that group, I'm still in the temporal mode, and therefore the guiding principles are not Shruti but Smriti. So then the question becomes, how do you write Smritis? Who writes Smritis? This is the issue. The bottom line, after discussing India's grand narrative, really should come down to who's going to write the Indian Smriti? Who? Us. So the idea of writing Smriti is not that one person, the king will commission, the government will put a committee, then sit down and write this grand narrative called the new Indian Smriti, called constitution or whatever you want to call it. This is where I think a lot of people have to participate, a lot of debates have to happen, a lot of experiments have to take place. But it has to be done with some principles like mutual respect, like open architecture. So what I'm espousing is that it should be minimalistic. It should be what we disallow. We disallow disrespect. We disallow closure and fixation with history centrism. So there are certain things. If you see my book, Be Different, I have them, and then I develop this further in Indra's Net. I've written a list of what I would disallow, and then everything else is allowed. And what is disallowed is basically that which will cause tension and violence and problems, and everything else is allowed. And so in that spirit, we have to co-create and co-author the narrative.
What I'm asking is, why mutual respect? If they think that we are going to hell, well, okay, we go to hell, but we really know who is going to hell.
So, that's a good question. Why do we bother? See, there is a strategy to take the high moral ground with an offer which they cannot accept because it will undermine them. If they accept the mutual respect offer, then the core tenets in their books are gone because they are required not to respect, they cannot be. Yeah. And yet, it is an offer which they cannot with a straight face deny either. So it's a strategy that puts them in an awkward position. And by putting people in an awkward position, making them think that they are stuck, they are prisoners of history, we may liberate them from that. So the point is, rather than people duplicitously going around pretending this hypocrisy, that oh, I tolerate you, all the interfaith conversations until 3 years ago, 100% of them that I looked at talked about tolerance. Now you will find Huffington Post, after I wrote these articles, their main editor of religion, he writes about mutual respect. At least the language is starting to change. But of course, they won't let me challenge them whether they're really living up to that. But at least the first step is that if the language they're changing, hopefully we can push them further and their real ideas. See, once they really start mutually respecting, they will be forced to go back to their texts and challenge those texts, revise them, change those interpretations. I'll tell you a very interesting anecdote. Before the year 2000, in the late 90s, I was involved in Cornell University. They had a religion event, and I mentioned this incident in Being Different. The chair of the Department of Religious Studies lady was very excited about creating a big international conference in the year 2000 to mark the new millennium, and they would bring the top leaders of all the religions. So some Vatican would send somebody, the Dalai Lama would come, all these people would come, and their purpose would be that in this new millennium there should be no religious conflict, and all the religions will make these pledges that there will be no conflict. So what I told her is that some of the books are causing conflict, because everybody says I'm a victim of somebody else, but look at their own books, they have things about other people that are causing conflict. So what I said is, they wanted a grant from my foundation to help them organize this contest. So I said, what we do is we have 3 years for the contest. So we'll take graduate students from the religion department. We'll have at least one student per religion, from each religion. And they'll make a committee. And this committee will scan the sacred books of all the faiths. So they'll scan Bhagavad Gita, they'll scan Quran, they'll scan Bible, like that they'll scan. And anything which is an action against outsiders, could be kafirs, could be infidels, could be whatever, will be highlighted. And then we will make a list of all the verse number this and verse number that for every one of those texts which is offensive and causing violence or causing action of some sort against outsiders. And a resolution will be passed in this international conference by all the religious heads that we will no longer teach these verses anymore. I thought it's very logical. She was so excited. He said, this is very smart. This is creative. We'll make history. So I said, fine. So months later, I had heard from her. So I called her up and I said, her name was Jane Mary Law, I remember. So I said, what happened? She says, everybody is throwing rocks at me, except the Hindus and Buddhists. They have no problem with this. They say, okay, if some part of our text is bad, we will not teach it. But the Abrahamic religions, they say, who are you to doctor our religion? Who are you to amend it? Who are you to delete it? It is blasphemy and we are not supposed to do that. And I try to tell them, I'm not deleting any text. I'm saying, don't teach it anymore. But not allowed. So I think they are really fixated on this issue of history-centric texts. Preventing mutual respect is the, I'm trying to push it to that point where people accept and face, that's really a major problem we have in conflict in this world.
This is something that I want to talk to you all here about, and that's the idea is that why do we talk about narratives and about Hinduism, about religion, about international relations? Why do we talk about this? If you go beyond and think and deliberate, you will come to the answer that we want peace and fulfillment of humankind's potential. Yeah? If I'm incorrect, please stop me here. So, once we realize that this is our superordinate goal or our ultimate aim, we then move forward to thinking and debating and discussing in settings like these. Now the next question is, are we the right kind of people to discuss this? Well, my answer is not exactly. Because the kind of education you and I have been through, we come from a compromised position. Because in your history textbooks and in my history textbooks back in 7th or 8th grade, we studied one chapter for every Mughal emperor and just a paragraph for the Vijayanagara Empire, which had 350 years of Indian history. Right? No?
More or less.
Yeah. So basically, if this is the kind of information that we're exposed to, our thinking is compromised. Right? So number one, we need to go back and think if we have the right kind of information, because it hinders the kind of thought that comes henceforth. Right? The second point, the concept of narrative. Why is a grand narrative needed? It is needed because if you don't have it, you will perish. Yeah? Because any group of people, any person, anyone, if it does not know who it is and what its purpose is, it will perish. Right? Then connecting the dots, if we come from a compromised position, we have to get a better understanding of who we are. We know the value of grand narratives. Let's go back and look at our religion in another light. Let's understand Hinduism without saying that Rama went to fight with Ravana during the Ramayana. The more R we add, the more learned we feel about ourselves. Right? So let's go beyond that and understand Hinduism in the right light. And concluding this, if you understand Hinduism in the right light, you will know one thing, and that's Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, Sarve Sindhu Niramaya, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kashchitu Bhagave. It encompasses all kinds of things, including diversity, including peace, harmony, fulfillment, everything. And if you see, this is peace and fulfillment of humankind's potential. And if you don't know where you come from, you won't be able to tell where you're going. So with that thought, I'll try to thank you all. And yeah.
I would just like to say, you know, listening to everybody, that it is the grain of consciousness that we hold within ourselves that is the key to our evolution or our revolution, so to say. In this whole debate about Hinduism or not being Hindu, I think we forget to be ourselves, you know, and that is very, very important. The moment the dialogue moves to us and they, then there is going to be problem, because that is the division that we've created in our own consciousness. And we, I mean, even in terms of religions or even revealed religions, I think, you know, in India, it is very easy to make Christ into an avatara, or, you know, anybody else into an avatara, simply because the fact that, you know, there is that openness that exists, that, you know, that they were also, that there was a message of spirituality that they had, and then we must be able to imbibe that. And similarly, we need to look at traditions, African traditions, other traditions, and the way they are also making a synthesis for their own selves. And that is very, very important, because I think there is no one grand narrative and it cannot exist. And this need for it should be something, then, you know, it should, we should see it as something that is emanating from a deeper insecurity within us. Sri Aurobindo said that we must lose our, you know, militancy of nationalism soon enough, not, you know, focused on self-preservation, so that we can we should be able to appreciate other cultures and, you know, the gifts that they bring to us much more. So that is also one point I'd like to make. Thank you so much.
I'd just like to say a couple of things. One thing, but I guess it's all connected. I personally think that to reduce the very idea of narrative to religion is very problematic. I don't think we should do that at all. And the second thing I'd like to say is that I do not think we need a grand narrative of India. I think the only narrative of India that exists is the narrative of diversity, and that needs to be preserved. I personally think that narrative or narratives cannot be anchored in time and space. They must not be. In fact, I have a problem with the concept of negating history, because when you say that you should not be history-centric, are you negating history? We mustn't negate history. It is history which will help us to understand where we are today. In fact, if we negate history, we will create a narrative that will only divide us, not a narrative that will bring us together. And therefore, I think that the litmus test of any narrative is the Constitution. We have to look at that as our basic frame and look at it as a continuum, nothing that is tied to a time or space, but something that is a continuum.
I think this is full of contradictions, full of contradictions, because you're one thing saying something, then you're saying something else. So firstly, you're saying you don't need a narrative, but you need constitution. Well, that is the grand narrative. Okay, you don't need a, we are not talking about religion anyway. I have written pages and chapters and chapters.
I'm responding to something else.
Yeah, no, I understand. But the Dharma tradition is not a religion. Anyway, so that doesn't come in. I agree with you that diversity is the narrative. And so that is the Indra's net narrative. It is the narrative of diversity that we are agreeing. I think we are agreeing on that. So if you are saying that diversity is the essence of our narrative, I think we can conclude on, we both agree on that. Wonderful.